Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Today's lecture is regarding a very important topic. If you all would have been in Europe or USA, I think this would have been the number one topic for any dermatitis, because atopic eczemas are much more commoner and much more concerning issue in Western countries than in Pakistan, probably because of their typical environment. However, even in Pakistan, atopic eczema is very important because of its various psychological and physical complaints and disabilities. So let's start with the lecture. Atopic eczema is an itchy, chronically relapsing inflammatory skin condition that often starts in early childhood, that is usually before 2 years of age. So onset of eczema in early childhood is one of the very important feature of atopic eczema. Atopic eczema can develop later in life, but this is a rarity. It's a rash which is characterized by erythemata. It's a rash which is characterized by erythema, itchy papules and papulovesicles, which may become excoriated, lichenified, and have a typical flexural distribution. As I will explain to you later, the rash has both acute as well as chronic features. So if it is an acute rash, then it will be papules and papulovesicles and crusting. If it is chronic, then it would be lichenified and thickened plaques. The eruption is frequently associated with other atopic diathesis. The patient harboring a filaggrin mutation are associated with ichthyosis vulgaris, keratosis pilaris, and hyperlinear palm. And such patients have an increased incidence of developing atopic eczema. I used the word atopic diathesis before. So what is atopic diathesis? Atopic diathesis include personal or family history of asthma, allergic rhinitis or allergic conjunctivitis, and atopic dermatitis, or predisposition to overproduction of immunoglobulin IgE antibody. So requirements can occur together, or either of the two can be called as atopic diathesis. Individuals with atopic eczema, can have a normal or elevated IgE level. So it is possible that the patient may have a normal IgE level and is suffering from atopic eczema. It is still a matter of debate whether the group with dermatitis and normal IgE levels should be termed an intrinsic atopic eczema or non-atopic eczema. But it is just a debate. All patients with typical clinical features, whether having high IgE or not a high IgE, will be labeled as atopic eczema. In European Academy of Allergy and Clinical Immunology proposed, the definition of atopy is a personal or family tendency to produce IgE antibodies in response to low-dose allergens, usually proteins, and to develop typical symptoms of asthma, rhinoconjunctivitis, or dermatitis. Again, what I told you in this slide is repeated here in this definition. So atopy is a personal or family history to produce increased IgE in response to low dose allergens and manifest as asthma, rhinoconjunctivitis, and eczema. UK, refinement of Hanfin and Rajka diagnostic criteria of atopic eczema. In order to qualify as a case of atopic dermatitis, the child must have, the first is the most important, and itchy skin condition. Or the parental report of scratching or rubbing in a child. Either the skin condition is visible or the parents report that the child is unduly disturbed by itching or scratching. In addition to this itchy skin condition, there should be any at least three of the following five features. Onset below 2 years of age, and not choose if child is under 4 years. Onset below 2 years of age, then history of skin crease involvement. That is cheeks under 10 years. History of generally a dry skin. Personal history of other atopic diseases like asthma or rhinoconjunctivitis, or visible flexural dermatitis, or dermatitis of cheek, forehead, and outer limb of the children under 4 years of age. So, itchy skin condition is must. And in addition to the itchy skin condition, the patient should either be of lesser age or having a history of skin crease involvement, dry skin, personal history of atopy, or flexural dermatitis. The patient, this is the diagnostic criteria of atopic dermatitis based on Japanese Dermatological Association. This is a more simplified version, and it has three features. A basic criteria, regardless of the severity. Number one is a pruritus or itchy skin condition, typical morphology and distribution of eczema. And number three is chronic or chronically relapsing course. So typical morphology for acute lesion, it is erythema, exudation, vesiculopustules, and crust. And in chronic lesions, infiltrated erythema, lignification, and scales. As far as the chronic or chronically relapsing course is concerned, more than 2 months in an infancy, more than 2 months per year, and more than 6 months a year in childhood, adolescence, and adulthood. So itchy skin condition with typical morphology and chronic relapsing course will qualify to be labeled as atopic. The definitive diagnosis of atopic eczema requires the presence of all the three features without any consideration of severity. So we are not considered that how severe are the features. We are just concerned that they should all be present for a rash to be labeled as atopic. So the thing which is different in this criteria from the Hanfin and Rajka criteria is this chronic or chronically relapsing course. This point is not mentioned in this criteria. Although this criteria include the personal history of atopy and generally a dry skin, but it does not include that relapsing course. So both these two criteria are important in their own aspect. Epidemiology. Atopic eczema is now a worldwide phenomenon with lifetime atopic eczema prevalence of well over 20% in many affluent country settings. There is increased prevalence in low-income countries, in particularly Africa and East Asia. So this word, the affluent countries, the word affluent here used means that atopic eczema is somehow a disease of rich. Usually it is not a common happening in patient belonging to the middle class or the lower class. Atopic eczema starts during infancy, usually less than 2 years of age. In Japanese study, there is 10% incidence at the age of 20 to 29 and 5% after 50 years. So this study shows that occurrence of atopic eczema is not a rarity in older age. So even in 20 to 29 years of age, there are 10% incidence of atopic eczema and 5% at 50 years. Slightly higher prevalence among female is not a consistent feature. Severe cases are unusual, usually less than 5%. The psychological morbidity associated with a lifetime of scratching, sleep loss, and stigma of visible skin disease can also affect families to a considerable degree. So not only the patient are psychologically disturbed, but the family members, usually mothers of atopic children, are equally psychologically disturbed. Atopic eczema is a costly disease, estimated on average to account for about $338 per year per individual. So not only the disease is among the rich people, but it consumes a lot of money for treatment. The precise lifestyle and other environmental ingredients that are responsible remain to be determined, although there are lots of theories about it. Pathophysiology. Atopic eczema involves abnormalities not only of immune regulation, but also a range of primary functions of epidermis. So in pathophysiology, consider these two aspects: the immune dysregulation and epidermal barrier damage. Filaggrin insufficiency predisposed to barrier dysfunction. But additionally, T helper 2 cells, cytokines interleukin 4 and 13 can also downregulate filaggrin expression, indicating a complex interplay between epithelia and immune system regulation. So there are two limbs in immunology, the Th1 and Th2. Th1 is mainly responsible for cell mediated immunity, and we see this response in psoriasis. And Th2 is mainly responsible for antigen-antibody reaction. And we see this as in atopic eczema. So in atopic eczema, there is an interplay between Th2 cytokines and the epidermal barrier function. 6 genome screens have been reported in German and Scandinavian studies. A recent analysis increased the number of genes to 13. Most of these candidates have been identified in association with other diseases, other atopic diseases like asthma, allergic rhinitis, and inflammatory conditions. Then filaggrin genetics is very important as far as the pathogenesis of atopic dermatitis is concerned. Loss of function variant of filaggrin is approximately 50%. Is seen in approximately 50% of severe atopic eczema. Not in routine atopic eczemas, but in severe atopic eczemas, 50% of them will be having some loss of function of filaggrin. This supports the view that skin barrier is critical in atopic eczema. Filaggrin comprises a large number of diverse proteins, which are critical for skin barrier formation. These proteins include loricrin, involucrin, S100 and others. So all these proteins, they comprise of filaggrin. At least 20 filaggrin variants have been identified in European population. Metabolism of filaggrin monomers release component amino acid, which contribute to epidermal water retention through their hygroscopic properties. So these protein components, which are produced by the filaggrin, they produce that lipid bilayer, the epidermal barrier, which is hygroscopic and which prevents the water loss from the from inside. And if this function is lost, then the patient becomes more susceptible to develop allergies and atopic eczema. Lipid in skin barrier. It has been recognized for years that reduced extracellular lipid and impaired ceramide production were characteristic of atopic eczema epidermal barrier defect. So this is the second cause of epidermal barrier defect. The first was defect or genetic defects in filaggrin genes and filaggrin production synthesis. Precisely how this link with filaggrin deficiency remained to be established, but following is possible: that corneocyte flattening, loss of natural moisturizing factor, and impaired lipid bilayer would mediate primary skin barrier. So just remember that lipids are secreted by the keratinocytes, and this lipid plays a role with phlegrin in making a perfect epidermal barrier. And if this lipid skin layer is damaged because of corneocyte flattening or because of loss in natural moisturizing factor, then it would result in barrier defect in atopic dermatitis. So there are different other factors that would influence the epidermal barrier and would become make the patient more susceptible to develop atopic dermatitis. Climate is one of the factors. Atopic eczema symptoms correlate positively with latitude. Latitude means that if you move away from the equator, the latitudes increases. So as the latitude increases, that means if you are going towards the North Pole or South Pole, the environment becomes cooler and the chances of developing atopic eczema becomes more. That is the reason why atopic eczema is more common in European countries. And negatively with annual outdoor temperature. It is another way of saying the same thing. That is, higher the temperature, lesser is the chance of developing atopic eczema. So in other words, atopic eczema is a condition of low temperature climate. Lower outdoor temperatures, especially in combination with the skin irritants, can contribute to disease worsening. Ultraviolet radiation and humidity, as well as seasonal change in pollen count, are likely to interact with the skin and cause atopic eczema. Differences in hygiene-related exposures, parasitic, bacterial, viral infection, vaccination, antibiotics, and farm environment, allergen exposure and sensitivity, diet and infant feeding, have all received particular attention, and I will be discussing each and all of these factors. Environmental pollutants which have a role in atopic eczema, they include smoke, dust, house dust, carpet, mite, dander, pets, and curtain pollen. So just remember these factors, that these are the advices which you would be giving to your patients. Environmental microbes, hygiene hypothesis. It is aggravated by Malassezia, yeast, and by staphylococcal toxin. While hepatitis A virus, H. pylori, and toxoplasma is somehow protective. Diet. Many people would ask you this question, okay, what are the diets to be avoided in atopic eczema? This is always a controversial topic. Cow milk, egg, soya bean, nuts, wheat, gluten, and cereals. They all contribute in aggravation of the rash. Food elimination diet may be helpful in a subset of patients with atopic dermatitis. Food allergies among children tend to diminish with age. And with exception of nuts, that means nuts will keep on making the disease worse. Most children with food allergies eventually tolerate milk, egg, soya, and beef. After 12 to 24 months, restricted food may be reconsidered for inclusion in the diet. So if initially the atopic eczema is severe, then you would advise such dietary restriction. But as the children get older and eczema becomes better, you can include diets one by one. And nuts will be the thing which should be introduced the latest. Breastfeeding and obesity. Many advocate breastfeeding as well as a way of prevention of atopic eczema. However, meta-analysis failed to show benefits. Obesity and physical exertion. A strong association of atopic dermatitis and obese children is reported. These are all associations. Pollution and tobacco smoking. Traffic-related air pollution, including nitrogen oxide and carbon monoxide, may contribute to atopic eczema risk, but association is weak. There is less evidence that atopic eczema risk in offspring increases in association with maternal smoking during pregnancy or environmental tobacco smoking. So although people say a lot about tobacco smoking, and atopic eczema, but their exact relationship is not known. Basic hygiene. Study found that general hygiene measures at the age of 15 months, such as frequency of washing and use of household cleanser and wet wipes, are weakly associated with increased risk of atopic eczema. So that means if you are a cleanliness nut, that you are trying to clean your baby a lot with soaps and cleansers, then he or she would be more predisposed to atopic eczema, of course, because of the loss of epidermal barrier. Then there are, what is the role of farm environment and animals? This is a strange observation that consumption of unpasteurized farm milk during the first 2 years of life is an independent protective factor against atopic eczema development. Once the raw cow milk is boiled, the protective effect is lost. You can say that this is one of the factors why this atopic eczema is not seen in farmers and in people belonging to village background. In addition, direct contact with farm animals reduced atopic eczema risk in early life in some settings, suggesting that perinatal priming of immune system may be of particular importance. That means if the more you restrict the child from the environment, which includes the environment with animals, the more are the chances of getting atopic eczema. Likewise, farm animals, pets have been implicated as potentially protective against atopic eczema. Protective effect of dog exposure while less with cat exposure. So just remember that these all are the studies which are not very significant, but they are trying to prove the significance of each of these factors. Helminth parasite. Relationship between helminth parasite and effect of immune system of human host is rather complex. Perinatal priming of immune system can provide protection against atopic eczema. So this is the after this animal contact and the unpasteurized milk, and this is another factor that even the farm animals and even the helminthic exposure would protect against atopic eczema just by priming the immunity. Childhood infection. A small increase in atopic eczema is associated with two or more antenatal infections. While more specific viral and bacterial childhood infections, such as chickenpox, mumps, whooping cough, and measles, either positive or no association between infection in early life and subsequent atopic eczema. So after the end of the discussion, you can say that childhood infections have a little or no role in aggravation of atopic eczema. Antibiotics. Causally linked with increased risk of developing atopic eczema. The effect which is particularly strong for broad spectrum antibiotics versus penicillin. It is possible that increased risk associated with antibiotics is due to change in host microbiota leading to enhanced immune response to environmental antibiotics. You see, why you avoid antibiotics in younger age, because these antibiotics would affect the gut flora. And because of the effect on the gut flora, it will lead to enhanced immune response to environmental allergens, which would not occur if the gut flora is infected. So in end, you would say that antibiotics, broad spectrum antibiotics, inadvertently used or more excessively used for minor indications will predispose children in developing atopic eczema. What is the microbiome of the gut and what is its role to atopic eczema? Early gut microflora of children who later develop atopic eczema has more Staph aureus and coliform and less lactobacilli and bifidobacteria. That means the patients of atopic eczema has a different microbiome of the gut. It is well established that Staph aureus is a major cause of skin infection and disease exacerbation and chronicity in atopic eczema. And this is mainly because of Staph toxin. Then coming to the immune dysregulation. After discussing all the factors which are contributing to the disease, now the internal factor. Variety of primary immune deficiencies, including Wiskott-Aldrich syndrome, hyper-IgE syndrome, Omenn syndrome, give rise to eczematous rash, which suggests that immunological dysfunction alone can result in cutaneous inflammation, which is typical of atopic eczema. The cellular infiltrate in early lesional atopic eczema is predominantly T lymphocytes. And CD4 are much higher than CD8. And eosinophils are also present. Allergen specific Th2 response. Allergens evoke Th2 response in lymphocytes from atopic patients, but not in healthy control. Modulation of Th response toward Th1 response is an indication of disease improvement. Increased number of cells expressing interleukin 4, 5, and 13 in early lesion of atopic eczema as compared to non-lesional skin. Interleukin 4, 5, and 13. These are interleukins of Th2 response. Interleukin 4, 13, and 17 downregulates filaggrin expression in keratinocytes, thereby inducing further epidermal barrier disruption. So, in addition, these interleukins will also reduce the barrier function, affect the barrier. In chronic atopic eczema, interleukin 5 and granulocyte macrophage colony stimulating factor, interleukin 12 and interferon gamma predominate. Interleukin 22 increasingly recognized as key cytokine in atopic eczema pathology. Interleukin 22 is also now considered to be one of the important cause of psoriasis. Then regulatory T cell exist in counterbalancing pro-inflammatory environment. In relevance to atopic eczema, glucocorticoids used to treat the condition have been reported to increase T regulator cell population, which may contribute to sustain anti. So the T regulator cells are the cells which check the undue proliferation of Th helper and cytotoxic cells. And the T regulator cells are promoted or produced by glucocorticoids, which are given as a treatment in atopic eczema. Atopic march. Atopic march describes the progression of atopic eczema to other atopic diseases, including allergic rhinitis, food allergies, and asthma. It is quite common that a child who reports to you for atopic eczema will be having one or more other atopic manifestation. IgE binding to multivalent antigens results in immediate release of inflammatory mediators, including histamine, and slower release of prostaglandins and leukotrienes. The release of histamine induces vasodilation, that is classical wheal and fair. Internalization of IgE bound antigens on the cells enhance uptake of antigen for processing and presentation of T cells, leading to priming and proliferation of allergen-specific T cells. The previous studies have associated total IgE, specific IgE, and number of IgE-mediated allergic reactivities with AE sensitivity. It is unclear if there is any meaningful difference between individuals with raised IgE as compared who do not. So this is again the same discussion which was started in the early phase of this lecture, that whether the high IgE level is must for labeling the patient as atopic eczema. And in the end, it is said that atopic IgE level may be normal and the patient may be having the typical signs and symptoms of atopic eczema and will be labeled as atopic eczema. High level of IgE is considered to be induced by staphylococcal super antigens. That's why the staphylococcal antigens play a role in causation of atopic eczema. Omalizumab, that is Xolair, is anti-IgE therapy, which is shown to be effective in treatment of asthma, but has a questionable role in treatment of atopic eczema. Both intrinsic and extrinsic atopic eczema demonstrate raised level of circulating eosinophils. Histamine concentrations during itch are no different between atopic eczema and controls. And non-sedating antihistamines is not very effective in atopic eczema as it is effective in urticaria. So even though histamine is considered to be released, but still the antihistamines have not a major role. And we use antihistamines, usually of first generation, in the treatment of atopic eczema and to suppress the itch, mainly because of its sedative property. Food allergies we have discussed before. Atopy patch test. This is a little different from the normal patch test. To further explore allergens implicated in atopic eczema, development of atopy patch test, however, its use remained controversial. Briefly, an atopic patch test consists of petrolatum preparation of protein allergens applied in 12 mm. Usually the normal fin chamber is 8 mm. So atopic patch test, the only difference is that the fin chamber is 12 mm. That is 4 mm larger. But otherwise, it is similar to the atopic patch test which we perform in allergic contact dermatitis. It is applied for 48 hours in non-abraded, non-tape stripped skin upper back. The test is read at 48 and 72 hours, assessing erythema as well as number and distribution pattern of papules. So atopic patch test is a preferred test as compared to skin prick. Since there are increased chances of having allergy and atopic eczema, so there has to be some relation between allergic contact dermatitis. Allergic contact dermatitis describes the immune response principally targeting the chemicals applied directly to the skin. Although allergic contact dermatitis demonstrates clinical and histological similarities to atopic eczema, immunophenotypes are distinct, and there is no suggestion that general atopic eczema reflects just yet unidentified allergic contact dermatitis. So the relationship between these two diseases is not a well-established association. Infection. Patients with atopic eczema are particularly susceptible to skin infection, particularly Staph aureus. So Staph aureus not only is the cause of atopic eczema, but it is a frequent infection in atopic eczema also. In addition to Staph aureus, human papilloma virus induced warts, fungal infection and viruses such as herpes virus 1 and 2, vaccinia, coccidii and pox virus and molluscum contagiosum are also frequently associated with atopic eczema. Kaposi variceliform eruption, as you all have read, has more chances of developing in atopic eczema. Innate immunity is compromised in atopic eczema. Production of IgA, a key epithelial antimicrobial immunoglobulin, is also reduced in sweat and tears of patients of atopic eczema. It is widely accepted that systemic antibiotic therapy is indicated in clinically infected atopic eczema, but with regard to chronic atopic eczema without clinical site of infection, there is uncertainty about the role of antimicrobial treatment. Having said that, I would just add here that many of the dermatologists treat atopic eczema even if there is no sign of infection with a short course of antibiotics which are effective against Staph aureus. So such as Claricid. So in case of severe atopic eczema, even if there are no signs of overt infection, you can give Claricid. It is a practice which I have been doing since quite some time. Then autoimmunity. Variety of autoantigens have been characterized in atopic eczema, as well as the presence of autoreactive T cells and IgE against autoallergens, which correlate with the disease activity. These autoallergens or autoreactivity contribute to chronicity and severity of atopic dermatitis. Pruritus is one of the important features of atopic eczema. And undoubtedly, pruritus is closely linked to inflammatory component of atopic eczema, as suggested by rapid resolution of itch with anti-inflammatory treatments such as cyclosporine. Histamine is best known pruritogen, and therefore, despite its limited relevance in atopic eczema, it is most widely studied. Many patients are aware that sweating induces itching and aggravates the condition. This may reflect altered sensations associated with neuropeptides released in neurogenic control of sweat glands. So sweating will always make atopic eczema worse. So such patients would be requiring cooler environment for their eczema. Psychological factor. Patients with atopic eczema commonly complain that their condition is exacerbated by episodes of psychological stress. And I would also like to say that atopic eczema itself causes psychological stress. So once the patient enters into the phase of anxiety, depression, and stress, then it is a vicious cycle. It multiplies. Now the clinical features. Majority of patients of atopic eczema will present with symptoms in childhood, usually 2 years of age. This is being repeated again and again, typically between 2 and 6 months, but may start at any age, even before the age of 2 months in some cases. The cardinal symptom is itch associated with chronic fluctuating rash and range of fever. So another point which I would like to stress here with you, that the age bracket of atopic eczema is similar to infantile seborrheic eczema. And many a time you are confused if the child is suffering from atopic eczema or seborrheic eczema. One of the features which you have all noticed is a cradle cap. So existence of cradle cap with generalized body eczema favors seborrheic dermatitis. However, in atopic eczema, there will not be such kind of greasy, scaly rash on the scalp, which is called as a cradle cap. But remember that if the itching is very disturbing in early childhood, you should think of atopic eczema more than infantile seborrheic eczema. Itch can be aggravated by warmth, sweating, bathing, exercise, emotional upset, woolen clothes, etc. The pattern of rash varies with the age. So how it varies? Infantile phase. That is before 1 year. Lesions most frequently start on the face, but may occur anywhere on the skin surface. Often the napkin area is relatively spare. When the child begins to crawl, exposed surfaces, especially the extensors of knee and elbow, are most involved. So in infant phase, before 1 year of age, extensor surfaces are involved. Lesion consists of erythema and discrete or confluent edematous patches, which are intensely itchy, exudative, and crusting. Disease runs a chronic fluctuating course, varying with such factors such as teething, infections, emotional upset, and change in humidity. This is a typical childhood atopic eczema. Now the childhood phase, that is from 12 months onwards, 18 to 24 months onwards. Now the site characteristically involved are the elbows and knee flexures, neck, wrists and ankles, the mixture of erythema, crusting, excoriation, hyper and hypopigmentation and warty lichenification may be seen. So the lichenification was not a feature in infantile phase. The side of neck may show striking reticulate pigmentation, which is typically called as atopic dirty neck, just like acanthosis. This is an atopic dirty neck. Involvement of hands often with exudative lesions. Acute generalized or localized vesiculation should always suggest the possibility of secondary bacterial or viral infection. So the flexural involvement in infant phase, in childhood phase, is typical of atopic eczema. Adult phase. The picture is essentially similar to the later childhood phase, with lichenification, especially in the flexures, frequently the face and hand involvement. Involvement of vermilion of the lips and adjacent skin is common in atopic manifestation. Photosensitivity is also associated in adults. So now in adult phase, the lesion is less exudative and more lichenified. But the typical sites are the same, that is the flexures. So in flexures, you will see the dirty neck type appearance. Atopic hand eczema. The hands may be affected in more than 50% of patients with acute atopic eczema. And the prevalence increases with age. A patchy, somewhat vesicular or lichenified eczema is common manifestation of atopic eczema in childhood. The nails are often involved, resulting in coarse pitting and ridging. Involvement of feet is also common. Diagnosis and differential diagnosis. So the point to differentiate is scabies, which is also a common condition in children, but there's a criteria of many family members involved. So this is easy to pick up. The differentiation of atopic infantile seborrheic dermatitis from atopic eczema can be difficult, as I have told you. Although with time and distinction, the distinction become apparent. Immunodeficiency state should also be considered in infants in whom the disease is unusually severe. Sometimes the atopic eczema is very severe and unresponsive to the usual treatment. So in such case, immunodeficiency diseases should be considered. An eruption resembling atopic eczema with or without other atopic disorders with raised IgE may be found in several rare disorders. So these are the disorders, like hyper-IgE syndrome or Job syndrome. There are increase in chances of developing infections, atopic eczema like rash, but no predisposition to other atopic manifestations. Hyper eosinophilic syndrome, A-gamma globulinemia, and hydrotic ectodermal dysplasia, ataxia telangiectasia, Netherton syndrome, phenylketonuria, Wiskott-Aldrich syndrome. So all these syndromes are characterized by immunodeficiency and a rash, which is typical of atopic eczema. So this table shows the severity of atopic eczema and severity of psychological impact. So as it shows, the severer the atopic eczema is, the severer is the effect on everyday activities, psychological functioning, loss of sleep. Classification of severity. There are numerous proposed scoring systems for assessing the severity of atopic eczema. And three systems are scoring atopic dermatitis, which is called as the SCORAD, eczema area and severity index called as ESSI, and patient-oriented eczema measures, which is called as POIN. Not going into the detail of these different systems. But generally speaking, mild is which have mild eruption, irrespective of the area. The moderate eczema is eruption with severe inflammation in less than 10% of the body surface area. Severe, 10 to 30% of the body surface area. Most severe, more than 30%. So the distinction between the less severe and more severe is depending upon the percentage of the body surface area involved by atopic eczema. Atopic eczema involving more than 30% of the body will be labeled as the most severe form of atopic eczema. Complications and comorbidities. Psychological aspects I have discussed already with you. It has a major contribution in atopic eczema. This can lead to negative effect on self-image and self-esteem, particularly during adolescence. And there is high incidence of anxiety, stress, and behavioral difficulty. Usually such patients are intelligent, and that is why they are highly sensitive. And there is distress at bath time and difficulty in going to sleep. Growth delays may be associated with atopic eczema, but it is usually seen in severe children, severely affected children, not in usual patients. And it is attributed both to oral and long-term topical corticosteroids. However, topical steroids, if used appropriately, then there is no risk of any growth delay. Secondary bacterial infection with staph or strep is virtually an integral part of the clinical picture, and it contributes many a time to exacerbation of the disease. And then I've already told you that such patients are more predisposed to viral infections and eczema, herpeticum, warts, and molluscum. Denny Morgan fold is a common skin finding. It's a lower eyelid fold, although it is typically seen in atopic eczema, but it is not a specific one. In addition, other ocular abnormalities are conjunctival irritation, keratoconjunctivitis, and keratoconus. Cataracts associated with atopic eczema is thought to arise due to combination of rubbing and use of topical corticosteroids and is always bilateral. Retinal detachment is also described, so lots of ocular problems associated with atopic dermatitis. Some cancers are increasingly seen like lymphomas. Then allergic rhinitis or hay fever asthma, which is common because of atopic diathesis. And since atopy is associated with inherently dry skin, and so ichthyosis vulgaris and KP is also seen in association with atopic eczema. Lip lecculitis. Lip lecculitis, you all know, is a common finding in children. And the lip lecculitis has a more chances of occurring in patients, children with atopic eczema. Food allergy is also contributing, and also is the thumb sucking and dribbling of the saliva. Majority of cases of urticaria cannot be, so contact urticaria is also common in atopic eczema. The disease course and prognosis. A well-defined population suggests that only 60% of children with atopic eczema grow out of their disease by adolescence, that is 10 years. You will be asked every time a patient of atopic eczema comes to you by the mother or a father that when our child is going to be all right. So you can say that 10 years. But 60% of children will be all right by 10. 40% will be carrying the disease in adult life. 25% of individuals relapse at some stage in adulthood. The factors with worse prognosis include severe childhood disease. So if the childhood disease is severe, then you can say easily that this child is not going to be all right after 10 years. If disease onset is in infancy and there is concomitant patients or the family history of other atopic diseases. Then there are three kind of diseases, three kind of atopic eczema. The first is a persistent disease, the disease which since its start has never literally gone from the patient. This is a persistent disease, and 19% of the patient will be having a persistent disease. Then intermittent disease is such kind of disease in which the patient becomes asymptomatic for a long period of time and becomes symptomatic again. So such kind of patients are 38%. Then there are 43% of the patient will be having remitting disease. Remitting disease is a disease which has aggravation, and it decreases in its severity but does not go completely like an intermittent disease. So the disease is there in less severe form, and sometimes it is aggravated and sometimes it is less severe. So such kind of disease is called as a remitting disease, and it is seen in 43% of them. Disease prevention. The focus has now shifted to epidermal barrier and its protection, and rapid healing with emollients from birth and vigorous early therapy should the dermatitis appear to prevent the atopic march and development of autoimmunity. Exposure of skin to irritant chemicals and physical trauma should be avoided. So now the disease prevention is based mainly on restoration and protection of epidermal barrier. Although there are no particular investigations, but we should order IgE level. Increased IgE would support atopic eczema, but normal IgE levels would not exclude it. Prick test serve only to confirm the atopic nature of individuals. Sometimes bacterial and virology swaps. Atopic patch test for aeroallergens and foods. Patch testing may be sometimes useful in contact allergens. So serum IgE can be ordered, specific serum IgE levels, peripheral eosinophil count, serum LDH. High LDH level increases shows disease progression. Serum thymus activation regulated chymokine level, or TARC, TARC. It reflects disease progression. And serum SCCA2, squamous cell carcinoma antigen level. So these two chemicals indicate the disease progression and severity, but still they are of research or theoretical. Before the management is planned, the patient should be assessed. There should be assessment of severity and age of onset. Current age, sex, social condition, and site of involvement. Complications and comorbidities, and impact on patient quality of life. If you are seeing a long case of atopic eczema, remember these four points in management. You should be not only stressing on these points, but should be able to explain to the examiners that you are looking for these points. That is assessment of severity and age of onset, current age, sex, social condition and sites, complications and comorbidities and impact on patient quality of life. First line treatment is reduction of trigger factors, regular emollient application and suppression of inflammation with topical corticosteroids. So these two factors, that is the regular emollient and topical corticosteroids, are two very important modalities of treatment in atopic eczema. Emollient should be maintained during remission, and more severe cases maintained of anti-inflammatory therapy. So even if the patient is not having any atopic eczema, the skin should not be left to be too dry. Sometimes oral sedating antihistamines and antibiotics may be added for short period of time. General advice in education: aim is to improve itch, sleep, reducing absentees from the school or work, and improving family interaction. Advice include knowledge of the disease, its triggering factors, the treatment options, likely benefits and risk, and demonstration of the use of topically applied medications, bandages, or bed wraps. So this demonstration is to be given to the family members, parents, or siblings. There are multiple trigger factors that provoke atopic eczema: skin irritants, wool clothing, winter dryness, excessive heat, sweating, food allergens, skin infections, airborne allergens, stress, and habitual scratching. So you just remember all these things, which are the advices you would be offering to the patient. Topical therapy, bathing and emollient. Bathing is soothing for majority of patients and is helpful when the skin is moisturized immediately afterward. Foaming detergents and soaps should be avoided, and soap substitutes like emollients used for cleansing. We use an ointment which is called as emulsifying ointment. I think you should be aware, you are aware of this thing. This ointment would make good lather if applied on a wet skin. So this can be used as a soap substitute. Otherwise, other soap substitutes are also available. In chronic lesions, ointments are preferred, particularly when lignification is prominent. If lesions are exudative, then creams and lotions can be used till the lesions get dry and then switched over to ointments. A generous quantity of emollients, 150 to 200 gram per week for children and 500 gram per week for adults, should be prescribed. Emulsifying ointment or Vaseline is sufficient. Since the recognition of importance of barrier function, numerous designer emollients, that is, there are lots of emollients in the market now, and time and again you will find a medical rep or a pharmaceutical company coming to you and telling you their emollient, saying that it contains these ceramides and these protective chemicals. So all of them are good, but it is said that a simple emollient like a Vaseline is as effective as any designer kind of emollient. The anti-inflammatory products. Now, once the inflammation sets in, there is erythema, there is papule, there are papulovesicles, there are severe itching, then we have to go to the second line topical treatment, and that treatment is the topical corticosteroids. So topical steroids predominate the inflammatory treatment of atopic eczema. Once daily treatment in evening, with morning application of emollients is recommended. So here the description in the treatment: the topical steroids are prescribed without any dilution. So the moderately potent steroids are to be applied in the evening, and emollients are to be applied in the morning. This will be the best combination. There appear to be no difference in efficacy or side effects between pulse potent corticosteroid creams and continuous mild topical corticosteroids patient with mild to moderate disease. So pulse means 3 days a week potent steroid like Provate or Clobivate, versus mild topical steroids like Betnuvate or like Hivate, Advinton or Cutivate, which can be applied daily. So this statement shows that there is no demonstrable difference in efficacy between the two. Educate the patient about the quantities to apply. For example, one fingertip unit, which is described as the amount of steroid which you can take in finger pulp. This finger pulp unit should be able to treat 2 palm-sized areas on the body. It would seem prudent to monitor the height and weight of young children if they have severe dermatitis. and if they are requiring frequently the topical or oral steroids. Local side effects will be present like telangiectasias on cheek, stria on the breast, abdomen, and which can be minimized by use of appropriate strength. There is a common practice of diluting the potent steroids. Such kind of dilutions will also result in less chances of having these skin thinning. When there are concern about the side effects, the topical corticosteroids should be switched over to topical calcineurin inhibitors like picrolimus and tacrolimus. Oral therapy. Sometimes in severe atopic dermatitis, we have to resort to oral prednisone. The dose is 0.5 milligram per kg. Course should be ideally be tapered over several weeks to avoid eczema flares. This is a common observation and practice that atopic that we prescribe the steroids very fearfully. So if you are treating a case which is response or which is steroid responsive, then especially in patients of atopic eczema where the disease flare-ups are common, there is no need to taper the steroids quickly. Do it gradually, slowly and gradually like we do in pemphigus so that the flares are avoided. Itch and antihistamines. Controlling inflammation is most effective treatment of itch. H1 receptor antagonists are used, mainly the type 1 or the first generation due to its sedative effect. It is better to give them at their bedtime. Non-sedating antihistamines are of little value. Infection and antibiotics, once again, we are discussing it. 90% of patients with atopic eczema are colonized with Staph aureus. And oral antibiotics like flucloxacillin and erythromycin are usually prescribed. In patients with regular flares of atopic eczema associated with infection, prolonged antibiotic treatment could be considered. Herpes simplex infection should be treated with oral antiherpetic medication. Then the maintenance therapy. The continuous use of emollient should be emphasized as often in mild disease. Prolonged control can be obtained with addition of intermittent use of topical corticosteroids. If relapse occurs, then topical corticosteroid can be used daily again for a week and then less, and then it is switched down to weekend therapy. Then topical calcineurin inhibitor is used to maintain control, switching over from steroids to topical calcineurin therapy. Adding a midweek use of tacrolimus ointment to topical corticosteroid weekend approach. So this approach is, the maintenance approach is, apply corticosteroid on the weekend, midday tacrolimus, and rest of the week emollient. Second line treatment. In unresponsive disease, but due to several factors, you be treated with second line treatment. One of the useful technique is wet wrap technique. What is a wet wrap? This is a useful technique for control of severe atopic eczema in young children. Two layers of absorbent tubular bandage are applied on the skin. Inner layer is pre-soaked with warm water and outer layer is dry. Generous quantity of low potency topical corticosteroid is applied to the skin before the dressing. So apply high weight or Advantin or hydrocortisone, then apply warm soaked bandage, then a dry bandage. The dressing can be used overnight or changed every 12 hours. It can be done once for overnight and can be done regularly 12 hourly. It is used in hospitals and short-term outpatient treatment. For localized area of lichenification, occlusive dressings, colloid dressing like Duoderm or paste bandage is used if the bandaging is easy. So such kind of bandages. Then topical calcineurin inhibitor, we have already discussed it. Just remember, for children give a lesser strain and for adult give 0.1%. Macrolimus, considered use in corticosteroid resistant facial dermatitis in children between 2 to 16 years. It is not available in Pakistan as far as I know. The typical attraction of calcineurin inhibitor is that they do not cause skin thinning, like seen in topical corticosteroids. Less chances of telangiectasia than bruising. There is concern of potential risk of lymphoma and skin cancer. However, there seems to be not much justified, and these agents have good safety profile. Food allergies, I've already told you about the food allergens and gradual introduction of food after 2 years of age. Aeroallergens, desensitization have a limited role. Contact allergens, these all have a role. Phototherapy in resistant cases or severe atopic eczema, broadband UVB, narrowband UVB, or medium and high dose UVA and PUVA are all effective. But currently, narrowband UVB therapy is more favored for chronic disease. A careful history prior to phototherapy should be excluded for any photosensitive disorder. Third line treatment. When the third line treatment will be required? If first and second line treatment fails, that you are unable to control the patient with topical and oral steroids, by emollient, with calcineurin inhibitor, and even with PUVA therapy. And then there are repeated failures. Then there are side effects because of first and second line. And if phototherapy is impractical or ineffective. So what are the third line agents? Cyclosporin, azathioprine, methotrexate, mycophenolate, mofetil. Cyclosporin is one of the most commonly studied immunosuppressive used in atopic eczema and after psoriasis. So it is a highly effective treatment. Initial dose is 2.5 to 3.5 mg per kg per day. And gradually it is increased to 5 mg per kg per day. Shows a good response within 6 to 8 weeks. However, the symptoms recur rapidly when the drug is discontinued. The same thing is observed in psoriasis as well. Whenever you need a very quick response in psoriasis, you give cyclosporin. But the problem of cyclosporin is that once you reduce the cyclosporin, the disease gets flared up. So it happens in atopic eczema as well. Azathioprine is not as effective as cyclosporin in atopic eczema. And its action is slower than cyclosporin. Methotrexate can be given in atopic eczema. The dose is 10 mg per week and increased by 2.5 mg weekly to maximum of 25 mg per week. And time to reach to the maximum effect must be 10 weeks. It is better tolerated than methotrexate. Should be reserved in severe cases. Mycophenolate mofetil does not show any good response or better response to cyclosporin, and can be given to those patients who are intolerant to azathioprine or methotrexate as fourth line agent. Remember, its side effects are gastrointestinal and leukopenia and lymphopenia and anemia. Then L-tretinoin. L-tretinoin is a new retinoic acid that has been developed in for the treatment of hand eczema and also used now for atopic eczema. This is something new. Then another new therapy is the biologics, which are used in atopic dermatitis. There is no evidence of use of anti-tumor necrotic factor alpha therapy in atopic eczema. Omalizumab, which is an IgE or monoclonal IgE antibody, has some benefit. Rituximab, which is again used in many other autoimmune disorders, it is effective in some atopic eczema with two infusions of 1000 mg 2 weeks apart. Then the new biological agent, which has now emerged as one of the important treatment modality in atopic eczema, is dupilumab. Dupilumab is a monoclonal antibody of interleukin-4 receptor. and block interleukin 4 and interleukin 13 signaling. In the start of my lecture, I told you that interleukin 4 and 13 are the main cytokines which are released by TH2 helper cell. And these are important in disturbing the epidermal barrier as well. It has shown efficacy in asthma. Then FDA has approved this drug for atopic dermatitis in children and used in children from 6 to 11 years with severe atopic dermatitis. There are two available doses in pre-filled syringe. So there are 302 ways to give the treatment. 300 milligram every 4 weeks for children between 15 to 29 kg. And 200 milligram every 2 weeks for children of 30 to 59. That is, dose is 300 milligram in children up to 29 kg, and dose is 400 milligram in children, 400 milligram per month for children between 30 to 59 kg. These are some fashionable products: probiotics, prebiotics, symbiotics. Just an introduction, because these agents are frequently used in the non-pharmacological treatment of atopic eczema, or you can say natural treatment. Probiotics are the live microorganisms yield useful effect on the host. Prebiotics are food ingredients promoting growth of microorganisms. Symbiotics are combination of probiotics and prebiotics. So there is a large meta-analysis in which the benefit of these probiotics have been proved in patients with early atopic eczema. Some Chinese herbal medicine are also being used. There are two different names and with some benefit. So that's all for atopic eczema. Now, जो चीजें समझ नहीं आई, you can ask me.
Sir, a question, please.
पूछे.
Sir, specific IgE antibody level बता दे. IgE levels तो हम कराते हैं. IgE का मतलब
है किसी specific allergen के खिलाफ. क्योंकि देखो, IgE एक anti-allergic and immunoglobulin है. वो आमतौर पे allergens के खिलाफ बनती है. फॉर एग्जाम्पल एंटी एग एलर्जिन के खिलाफ बन जाएगी, सोयाबीन के खिलाफ, वीट ग्लूटेन के खिलाफ बन जाएगी. तो नॉर्मल, एक तो नॉर्मल काउंट है आई जी ई का, और एक स्पेसिफिक काउंट है टू स्पेसिफिक एलर्जन.
तो सर, ये हम स्पेसिफिक एलर्जन को कैसे, मतलब
नहीं करते, लेकिन कर सकते हैं, लेकिन कर सकते हैं.
ठीक है.
जी
सर, बच्चों में मेथोट्रेक्सेट किस एज से सेफ है, उनकी क्या डोज?
टू इयर्स बच्चों में. मेथोट्रेक्सेट इवन यंगर में भी दे सकते हैं, लेकिन यूजुअली 2 इयर्स से ऊपर हम देते हैं.
ओके सर. और सर, उतनी की बॉडी वेट के हिसाब से जितनी एडल्ट डोज है?
नहीं, एडल्ट डोज कैसे हो सकती है? जो
नहीं सर, जितनी
देखो, बात ये होती है कि मेथोट्रेक्सेट को
छोटे बच्चों को देना.
मैंने ना बहुत, 2 साल के बच्चों को तो बहुत कम, लेकिन हाँ चाइल्डहुड में दिया जरूर है, बहुत ज्यादा दिया. बल्कि सोरायसिस में भी, और
में कोशिश करें देने,
मतलब समझ लें 6-7 साल, 6-7 साल में तो कोई मसला ही नहीं है ना सोचने में, देने में. और कई दफा ना आपको,
मेरा भी,
या एक मिनट, कई दफा ना आप ग्रोइंग एज में बच्चों को एसिट्रेटिन नहीं देते ना, क्योंकि उनकी ग्रोथ मुतासर होती है. और इस मौके पे बहुत सारी डिजीजे हैं जिनमें मेथोट्रेक्सेट देनी पड़ती है. अच्छा, बोले सवाल.
सर, मैंने पूछा था एडल्ट ऑनसेट एटॉपिक डर्मेटाइटिस हम 20 to 29 के दरमियान या 50 से ज्यादा वालों को कहेंगे?
नहीं नहीं, एडल्ट देखो, एक जो यूजुअल एटॉपिक एक्जिमा है, सारी की सारी डेफिनेशंस, सारे के सारे क्राइटेरिया एटॉपिक एक्जिमा को 2 साल 2 ईयर से पहले कहते हैं कि 2 ईयर से पहले ऑनसेट हो जाना चाहिए. अगर 2 ईयर्स के बाद हो रहा है तो वो चाइल्डहुड हो रहा है तब वो भी एडल्ट ऑनसेट नहीं कहलाएगा. एडल्ट यूजली वही होता है कि जो आमतौर पे 18 ईयर्स के बाद या 20 के बाद हम उसको एडल्ट कहते हैं. पहले हमारी इन्फेंट है, फिर हमारी चाइल्डहुड है, फिर हमारा एडोलेसेंस है, फिर हमारी टीन एजेस हैं. उसके बाद जो एडल्ट है ना, वो मुझे एग्जैक्टली याद नहीं, लेकिन समवेयर आफ्टर 20s. तो अगर तो एटॉपिक एक्जिमा 20s में डेवलप हो रहा है फॉर द फर्स्ट टाइम, देन यू विल कॉल इट एज एडल्ट ऑनसेट. वैसे को टीन एज ऑनसेट एटॉपिक एक्जिमा भी होता नहीं है, तो अगर फॉर एग्जांपल टीन एज में भी होगा तब भी उसको एटॉपिक एक्जिमा ही कहेंगे.
सर मेरा तो ओल्ड एज, सर मैं एटॉपिक डर्मेटाइटिस की पेशेंट हूं, मैं 13 इयर्स में ऑनसेट हुआ था.
आप खुद हो पेशेंट?
यस सर.
आपको 13 इयर्स में शुरू हुआ था?
यस सर.
अच्छा, मैं मेरा नहीं ख्याल कि इसको हम एडल्ट ऑनसेट कहेंगे, इसको जरा चेक करना पड़े, इसको चेक करना पड़ेगा मुझे.
सर ऑनसेट तो जिस एज पे पेशेंट मैनिफेस्ट किया है फॉर द इनिशियल टाइम, हम उसको वही लेबल करेंगे ना?
वही लेबल करेंगे. सही
जी
सर. एक और सवाल ये कि 13 इयर्स पे एडल्ट ऑनसेट कहलाएगा या चाइल्डहुड ऑनसेट कहलाएगा या
एडोलेसेंट ऑनसेट हो जाएगा?
एडोलेसेंट ऑनसेट कहलाएगा. एडोलेसेंट ऑनसेट ही है, लेकिन नॉर्मली क्राइटेरिया में तो नहीं आएगा वो.
सर मेरे
पहले ऑनसेट हुआ और डायग्नोज उनको 13 इयर्स में हुआ होगा,
ये तो खुद बताएंगी वो. 13 इयर्स तो काफी एज होती है.
13 इयर्स में व्हाट, 12 13 इयर्स में ही हुआ था सर. पहले जनरली ड्राई स्किन से स्टार्ट हुआ और उसके बाद फिर लेटर ऑन एक्जिमेटस.
तो क्या ऐसा तो नहीं था कि आपकी इनहेरेंटली ड्राई स्किन थी बचपन में?
नहीं सर, ड्राई स्किन मुझे नहीं याद पड़ता कि कभी मैंने इमोलिएंट्स अपने चाइल्डहुड में लगाए हैं या स्पेशल सोप्स हों.
अच्छा
सर एक क्वेश्चन मेरा और था कि नॉन सीडेटिंग एंटीस्टामिन ने क्या बताया था कि वो क्यों नहीं देते, क्यों इफेक्टिव नहीं होते?
जो हिस्टामिन का अगरचे प्रूराइटिस में रोल तो है, लेकिन बहुत स्पेसिफिक, जिस तरह अर्टिकेरिया में रोल है ना डिजीज कॉजेशन में, इस तरह ना बहुत स्पेसिफिक प्रूराइटिस में हिस्टामिन का रोल नहीं है. रोल साइटोकाइंस का भी है, रोल एपिडर्मल बैरियर्स का भी, मतलब मिक्स रोल है. तो इसलिए जो एंटी हिस्टामिन्स, अगर उनके अंदर सिडेशन नहीं है तो वो इतनी इफेक्टिव नहीं होंगे इच को सप्रेस करने में. तो अगर आपने एंटी हिस्टामिन प्रेफर ही करना है इन एटॉपिक एक्जिमा या इन एनी एक्जिमा, तो आप ऐसा एंटी हिस्टामिन दें जो सिडेटिंग रोल पे. मैं यूजली जर्टेक या रिजिक्स बहुत ज्यादा इस्तेमाल करता हूँ, मेरे ट्रेनिंग को पता है. अगरचे ये नॉन सिडेटिंग है, लेकिन इसमें सिडेशन का एलिमेंट है बाकी तमाम से, तो आप इस सिडेशन का एलिमेंट जरूर कंसिडर करें गिविंग एंटीहिस्टामिन स्पेसिफिकली फॉर प्रूराइटिस एंड नॉट फॉर एंटीहिस्टामिन प्रॉपर्टी.
ठीक हो गया, थैंक यू सर.
सर एक और क्वेश्चन है. सर ये जो हम लॉन्ग केस करते हैं क्रॉनिक एक्यूट डर्मेटाइटिस,
क्या करते हैं
तभी उसकी डीडीज में लगती है
क्रॉनिक एक्यूट
डर्मेटाइटिस? सर हम क्रॉनिक एक्यूट डर्मेटाइटिस की डीडीज में एडल्ट ऑनसेट एटॉपिक डर्मेटाइटिस की रखते हैं, तो उसकी मैनिफेस्टेशन जैसे हमने अभी पढ़ा है कि इसके फ्लेक्चर्स ही इन्वॉल्व होंगे, तो फ्लेक्चर्स के अलावा उसके फेस पे क्या ऐसा आएगा जो हम उसकी डीडी में रखेंगे?
देखो एटॉपिक एक्जिमा का मैंने आपको बताया ना, एक तो सबसे इम्पोर्टेंट चीज उसका प्रूराइटिस है, इचिंग इज मोर. नंबर टू उसके ना दो फीचर्स हैं, एक्यूट और क्रॉनिक. एक्यूट में एक्जुडेटिव लेजन है, क्रॉनिक में लाइकेनिफाइड लेजन. और तीसरा फीचर जो है ना वो उसकी एक्सर्बेशंस है, exacerbations and remissions. अगर एक adult onset disease है, उस patient को pruritus, उस patient की lichenification है आमतौर पर flexures areas में, और उसकी disease की exacerbation और remissions, और उसका history नहीं है aeroallergens की या airborne eczema की या photo exposures की ज़्यादा, तो फिर आप और plus उसकी पर्सनल हिस्ट्री है ऑफ अदर एटॉपिक डायथीसिस, या फैमिली मेंबर्स आर सफरिंग फ्रॉम एटॉपिक एक्जिमा, तो बाय द डायग्नोसिस ऑफ इंक्लूजन एंड एक्सक्लूजन आप उसको एटॉपिक एक्जिमा लेबल कर सकते। बाज दफा हमारे पास एयरबॉर्न डर्मेटाइटिस के पेशेंट आते हैं, पहला डायग्नोसिस हम एयरबॉर्न डर्मेटाइटिस कर लेते हैं, लेकिन वो मरीज बार 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 आपके पास आ रहा होता है ओपीडी में, तब आप कुछ अरसे के बाद रिकंसिडर करते हैं अपना डायग्नोसिस और आप कहते हैं कि नहीं, ये नॉर्मल एयरबॉर्न डर्मेटाइटिस नहीं है, ये एटॉपिक डर्मेटाइटिस है एडल्ट ऑनसेट, जब भी तो इसका ये एयरबॉर्न एक्जिमा ठीक ही नहीं होता, ठीक है। और एडल्ट ऑनसेट इज मेनली क्रॉनिक, जिसमें आपकी जो प्रोमिनेंट फीचर्स है ना वो थिकनिंग और लाइकनिफिकेशन, वो वेजिकुलेशन, पेप्यूल्स, पस्टूल्स, ये कम हो,
ठीक है। थैंक यू सर।
थैंक यू जी। ओके फिर खुदा हाफिज़।